Welcome to Animals Today, your home for serious talk about animals. I'm Dr. Lori Kirshner. Each week we receive at least one book for review that has to do with our relationship with dogs. The books come in the form of novels, memoirs, or collections of stories. Some take a spiritual angle, and others look at communicating with dogs after they have died. And some authors present cultural and anthropological angles of our shared evolution as a starting point to explore the intense connection many people have with dogs. And of course, we get children's books about dogs as well, lots of them. Truly, we often wonder, who is reading all these books? And yet they keep coming, a testament to our interest in reading them. Later in the show, we'll be joined by Los Angeles City Councilmember Paul Koretz, who has great news for elephants in the city. But first, to today's topic about dogs, and something different happened recently when we received a book titled How Dogs Love Us, a neuroscientist and his adopted dog decode the canine brain. Its author is neuroscientist Gregory Berns. Dr. Berns is Distinguished Professor of Neuroeconomics at Emory University. In addition, Dr. Berns and co-authors Andrew Brooks and Mark Spivak recently published their research in a paper titled Functional MRI in Awake, Unrestrained Dogs. Welcome, Dr. Berns.
Hi, Lori.
So it appears we are entering a new era in the scientific study of the canine brain and thereby our relationships with dogs. Greg, tell us a little bit about your background in neuroscience and how you became interested in studying dogs.
Sure. So for the last 15 or 20 years, I've been using MRI, specifically functional MRI, to study how the human brain works. And my interest in the human brain has always been focused on the human reward system and how these systems in our brains help us make decisions. You know, how does it work to help us approach the things that we like? How does it involve risk, the prospect of loss, all of these things. And that's basically what the field of neuroeconomics is about, is how the brain accomplishes these decisions. So I felt very comfortable working around the human reward system and understanding how that ties into our emotions and decisions. And kind of at the same time, I mean, I've always been a dog person. I grew up with dogs. I've had dogs all of my adult life. And I don't know why exactly, you know, what kind of clicked in my head a few years ago and why I didn't think of doing this earlier. I think it probably had something to do with when my favorite dog, a pug named Newton, passed away at the age of 15. And it just got me thinking, you know, I probably, like many people, just take it for granted that, you know, I love dogs and they love me back. But it got me thinking, I mean, what is this kind of emotion from the dog's perspective? Is it just about food or is it something else? And then, so that's kind of what started the ball rolling and I teamed up with a dog trainer to see if we could train dogs to go in an MRI completely awake and unrestrained so we could see how their brains function.
Okay. And what parts of the brain were you studying and why?
So, again, kind of starting with humans as a baseline, since we know a lot about the human brain and specifically the reward system. So most people have heard of the neurotransmitter dopamine, which is often thought of as a pleasure neurotransmitter, which is not really correct, but we focus on areas that are rich in dopamine. And the reason we do that is because what we've learned over the last 20 years is that dopamine is not so much a pleasure neurotransmitter, but it's a neurotransmitter that's released that helps mobilize the body into action. And if you think about it, you know, the circumstances where we have to mobilize our bodies is either when we really like something and we want to go get it, or when we don't like something and we need to get away from it. And so these are kind of the circumstances in which dopamine is often released. Now, the areas that they're released into is a very kind of focal set of parts of the brain. They have names like the caudate nucleus or the nucleus accumbens, and so we know where in the human brain these things are released. And when we look at humans, what we find is when there's activity in these parts of the brain, it's almost always associated with usually positive emotions, things that we like. So when we see activity here, it's usually caused by something we like and want to go and get. So what's interesting about dog brains, same as actually any other mammal, they also have the same part of the brain, caudate nucleus, nucleus accumbens. And as far as we know, it probably behaves in very similar, if not exactly the same way as it does in humans. So this is where we began our search for canine brain function and to get into the dog's experience, if you will.
Dr. Berns, explain to my listeners functional MRI and contrast it to conventional MRI.
Sure. So if you've ever had an MRI, usually a conventional MRI would, for diagnostic purposes, you would go in, and essentially what it does is it uses magnetic fields and radio waves to take pictures of certain parts of your body. So in the case of neuroimaging, we're usually talking about the brain. So a regular MRI that you would get would just take a picture, like a photograph. Now, in research, we use a slightly different technique, same scanner, but just programmed differently, to do something called functional MRI. And so the analogy is that it's more like a movie. So we would be taking a scan of the brain roughly every 1 to 2 seconds. And then what we're actually picking up is changes in blood flow. And we can use this information to figure out what parts of the brain are being active, because in many ways the brain is kind of like a muscle in the sense that when a particular part of the brain is active, it recruits more blood flow, and we can pick that up. So in our experiments in humans as well as dogs, what we do is we have the subject in the scanner actually doing something. For humans, they'll often be interacting with a computer screen and then giving responses of some sort. And then we can go back afterwards and figure out what parts of the brain were associated with various things that we present and the responses that the person gives. So that's exactly what we did with the dogs, too.
Where was the research conducted? Are the scanners dedicated for non-human animals?
So when we started this project, we were actually using an MRI in the hospital at Emory University in Atlanta, Georgia. Now, it's a scanner that's used primarily for human research, and that was the only scanner available to us. Since then, we've actually installed a new MRI in our psychology building here, which is also used for human studies, but it's also getting now a lot of use with dogs.
So now tell us about the subjects, the dogs in the study.
Yes. So when we started this, which is now, oh gosh, I guess it was over 2 years ago now when we started this whole crazy thing, my dog was actually the first subject. When we started, we didn't think this was actually going to work. In fact, everyone I told that we were going to try this, everyone kind of laughed at us. And the reason they laughed at us is because subjects have to hold absolutely still within millimeters. And nobody thought that a dog could be trained to do that, especially in the environment, which is quite noisy and claustrophobic for people. So we started with my dog, and part of the reason for that is I have always had this kind of ethical rule in my lab that, you know, we don't do experiments that we're not willing to do on ourselves or our family members, and that kind of keeps us from doing things that are unpleasant and ethically dubious. Now my dog, one of my dogs, Callie, in this case, was a rescue from the Atlanta Humane Society, and she's kind of a small 25-pound terrier mix of some sort. In the South, they call dogs like this feists. They kind of look like rat terriers. And I didn't think she was actually going to be able to do this because she really hadn't had a whole lot of formal training. In fact, I think she had flunked out of obedience, not because of her, mainly because of her humans not following through on the training. But she had one characteristic that made her an ideal subject for this, and that is her curiosity. So she's very inquisitive, and she's not afraid of new things, what we call neophobia, and she likes to do things. And it was those characteristics that made her a really good first subject, because she likes to learn new things and seems to be kind of in her element doing that.
Dr. Gregory Berns. Don't go away. More with Dr. Berns. And we're studying dogs' brains. You're listening to Animals Today.
Could switching to Geico really save you 15% or more on car insurance? Is texting getting way out of hand? You know, I can't... Oh, please. Oh, that is funny. Where was I? Oh, yes, about texting. Pardon me. LOL, you are my BFF. So, like I was saying...
Switch to Geico now and you could save hundreds on your car insurance. For a free rate quote, visit geico.com to see how much you could save. 15 minutes could save you 15% or more on car insurance.
Hi, this is Dr. Lori Kirshner, and I want to thank you for listening to Animals Today. Make sure to visit us on animalstodayradio.com, where you will see all our previous shows, and you can download them free. That's animalstodayradio.com. Also, make sure to become a friend on Facebook. Animals Today gets a lot of its support from the nonprofit group Advancing the Interests of Animals. Check them out at aianimals.org. And I hope you'll consider making a donation to help pay for the ongoing broadcast of Animals Today. Each week on Animals Today, we strive to bring you the highest quality, most up-to-date information about all animal welfare topics, and we certainly would appreciate your support. That website, again, is aianimals.org. And thanks for listening.
As temperatures climb, please remember to never leave your dog in the car, not even for a minute on a warm day with the windows cracked and in the shade. The temperature inside a car can climb up in a matter of minutes, and it's enough to kill your pet. If you love your pet, leave them at home or with someone you trust. Keep them cool, comfortable, and alive. And if you see a dog or other pet in a car, you may only have a moment to save their life. Here are a couple of steps that you should remember. Make an announcement in the store or business the car is parked nearest to, and call the police department or animal control right away. Remember, it only takes a minute or two on a hot day to kill an animal left inside a car. Your swift action can save a life. Dogs are unable to cool themselves the way people can. Never leave your dog in the car, not even for a minute.
This message is sponsored by Advancing the Interests of Animals. You can check them out at aianimals.org. That's the letter A, I, animals.org.
What is term life insurance? It's basically a financial protection plan for your family if you pass away. It can be a hard purchase. Think about it. It's one of the few major purchases you can make that you will personally never use. But you've got to have it to protect your family. And you owe it to yourself to shop and compare to get the best possible rates. For term life insurance policies of $500,000 or more, call the Term Lifeline today.
800-957-6068. That's 800-957-6068. Remember, we specialize in term life insurance policies of $500,000 or more, and we have great rates for smokers, too. So call today. 800-957-6068. 800-957-6068. That's 800-957-6068.
I just sneaked into my kids' rooms and took temperatures while they're sleeping, thanks to my Exergen thermometer. All I did was swipe their foreheads for a few seconds. It didn't even wake them up. My sister, the nurse, told us about the Exergen temporal scanner thermometer, and it's the best. Real value for the money and truly a lifesaver. Now I don't have to deal with ears or rears, if you know what I mean.
I'm Dr. Frank Pompei, founder of Exergen. Thousands of hospitals and clinics rely on temporal scanners. I'm confident you will too.
The Exergen temporal scanner. Pick one up at Costco and other fine retailers or visit us at Exergen.com.
Want an easy-to-install floor and an easy-to-save price? Then get to Lumber Liquidators because we've got all easy-click floors on sale in over 110 varieties. All laminate flooring is 20% off. Plus, get easy-click hardwood, easy-click bamboo, and more for up to 58% less than comparable floors at big box stores. Better yet, all Morningstar bamboo and Tranquility vinyl floors are on sale and get special financing. Better get clicking. Sales going on now. Visit LumberLiquidators.com or your local store today.
Welcome back to the program. I'm Dr. Lori Kirshner. We're speaking to Dr. Gregory Berns, author of the book How Dogs Love Us, a neuroscientist and his adopted dog decode the canine brain. Dr. Berns, explain the design of the experiment. While the dogs were in the scanner, what was done?
Sure. So the first experiment that we did was hand signals. So since we didn't know this was going to work, we needed to start with something very simple. And in order to do this, we had to get the dogs trained, and essentially what was involved with that was training them to walk up some steps onto the patient table and then shimmy down into the bore of the magnet and put their head in a chin rest in what we call the head coil, which is the thing that picks up signals from their brains. And they also had to learn to wear earmuffs as well to protect their hearing. So it all sounds really simple, but it actually took about 2 or 3 months to figure all this out.
So, and you sent me a YouTube of this, and I do want to stress this to my listeners. It was all very ethical. I love the way the dogs were trained, all positive reinforcement. You started out with a little metal device that looked like a the inside of a scanner, and it was done very slowly, and everyone seemed to look like they were having a great time. So just wanted to emphasize that.
Right. So, if you look at the videos, you'll see the dogs are wagging their tails throughout the whole thing. But actually, they have to learn to stop wagging their tails at the end because that causes their head to move in the opposite direction.
Right.
So to see if this actually worked, the first thing we did was, so initially me interacting with Callie, I would go around the other end of the magnet, and so she'd be facing me from inside, and I'd be looking at her and give her hand signals. And so we trained them. One hand signal meant hot dogs, and another hand signal meant no hot dogs. And this is about as simple as a task as we could imagine. And the reason we did that is because we knew where in the brain to look for these responses. We knew that the reward system should be active to these hand signals that indicate hot dogs. And that's, in fact, what we found. And there was actually initially another dog, a border collie named Mackenzie, who was also in the project, and her brain reacted the same way to her human giving the signals. And so that gave us confidence that we could actually do this, that the dogs would hold still long enough and the data was of good enough quality that we could interpret it. And then we moved on. So with just two dogs initially, can't really conclude a whole lot. So once people in Atlanta started hearing about this, it kind of word got out in the dog community, people started volunteering. And it's become the citizen science project now where we have many people in the dog community volunteering to participate with their dogs, and we're actually up to about 25 dogs in the project now. And with that number of dogs, now we can do really interesting things. So we've studied how their brains respond to the smell of their familiar humans in their household and the smell of other dogs in their household to try to understand who's the dog's bond with. Is it with the humans or is it with other dogs?
What have been the biggest surprises in the data you obtained?
So initially, we were both shocked and surprised and delighted that it even worked. But that's kind of old news now. So now with these dogs that we have, now we have a lot more dogs. Now what's amazing me is the differences between the dogs. So, so far we've been talking about dogs as if they're all the same, but of course they're not. They all have personalities and temperaments. And the question is, where in the brain do these differences arise, and how do these differences relate to how dogs actually behave? So one of the things I'm most excited about right now is that we're beginning to see differences in dogs that were trained as service dogs, and that they seem to have stronger responses in the caudate, this part of the reward system, when they're interacting with humans than other dogs. So my dog, Callie, certainly not a service dog, rescued at the age of 9 months, has weaker responses in that part of the brain than some of these retrievers that are service dogs. And so we don't know if that has to do with genetics or whether it's because the service dogs were raised in a way with strong human contact from a very early age, but we hope to sort that out.
And so would you be able to tell us something like what kind of music to play for my dogs during a thunderstorm by scanning them?
Maybe someday we will. We would very much like to understand anxiety in dogs, um, because, as we all know, I mean, anxiety is a real issue for many dogs, and especially separation anxiety. So it's particularly challenging for us because dogs that are anxious to begin with are not very good candidates to go in the MRI. So we're kind of brainstorming about trying to find dogs that are, say, a little bit anxious but not so anxious that they can't do the task, but we hope to figure things out like that.
And what are some of the other things that we might want to figure out with this?
Well, so anxiety is a big one. The issue of the dog-human relationship is at the foundation of everything we're doing. So we're trying to understand, you know, why some dogs, what parts of their brain are responsible for bonding with humans, why, you know, some dogs get bound to a single human, and why other dogs are, you know, less selective. And this kind of has a lot to do with the role of dogs in our society, you know, what makes for good service dogs, what makes for good working dogs, what makes for good companion dogs. Going, I think, way beyond just breed differences, but trying to get at the neural mechanisms behind this.
Greg, as you contemplate the broader meaning of your work, how does it relate to dog welfare overall and how dogs are treated in our culture?
Right, so, you know, dogs, of course, are treated as property under the law. And, when we started this project, I never really set out to be any kind of activist about this. I just wanted to know what my dogs were thinking and whether they loved me like I loved them. But as time has gone on and I've looked at more and more dog brains, I see more and more similarities to how human brains react. They're smaller, obviously, but when you get down to basic processes related to emotion, they look very much the same. And you begin to wonder kind of whether we should be treating them as more than furniture under the law. Certainly yeah. I feel that way. I don't know what the right answer is, but yeah. They're so important to us that they're more than that.
Has thinking about the brains of dogs changed the way you think about the brains of people?
That's a funny question. I think I like being around the dog brains more than the people brains.
I figured you'd say that. Dr. Gregory Berns, thank you so much. The book is How Dogs Love Us, A Neuroscientist and His Adopted Dog Decode the Canine Brain. It's available everywhere. It's really great. Thanks, Greg.
Thanks, Lori.
Roughly more or less, about exactly, almost close by and adjacent. Handy local, with inhaling, but the cloud then passes over, and you're vague, aloof, and distant. Isolated and secluded, far, far, far off.
Oh, $10,000 or more to the IRS that you can't pay? Call now for immediate help. 866-657-8517. At Community Tax Relief, we help consumers like you. If you take on the IRS alone, you could be facing levies, liens, even wage garnishments, personal or business tax issues. If you owe the IRS $10,000 or more, they will aggressively come after you. Protect yourself and your family today from what the IRS can do to you. Call now. 866-657-8517. They can freeze your bank account, even garnish your wages. Our expert team of tax professionals can solve your tax problems once and for all. Call now for a free 5-minute tax debt analysis. 866-657-8517. 866-657-8517. 866-657-8517.
If you're a responsible homeowner who's faithfully made your mortgage payments, you deserve thanks for doing the right thing. And I'd like to tell you about a powerful financial tool that rewards your responsibility. Hi, I'm Jay Farner, president of Quicken Loans. And the tool that I'm talking about is the Home Affordable Refinance Program, or HARP. HARP is designed to help you lower your mortgage payments. It's for responsible homeowners who are current on their payments, but due to the housing market, may have little or no equity left in their home. And even if you were unable to get a HARP loan in the past, new guidelines mean that now you may be eligible. Over 2.5 million homeowners have already taken advantage of HARP and are saving an average of $250 a month. If you're one of the millions yet to take advantage, call us today at 800-QUICKEN. To learn more, call Quicken Loans today at 800-QUICKEN or go to quickenloans.com. That number again is 800-QUICKEN.
Important terms and conditions apply. Call us for cost information. Equal housing lender. Licensed in all 50 states. NMLS number 3030.
What is term life insurance? It's basically a financial protection plan for your family if you pass away. It can be a hard purchase. Think about it. It's one of the few major purchases you can make that you will personally never use. But you've got to have it to protect your family. And you owe it to yourself to shop and compare to get the best possible rates. For term life insurance policies of $500,000 or more, call the Term Lifeline today.
800-957-6068. That's 800-957-6068. Remember, we specialize in term life insurance policies of $500,000 or more, and we have great rates for smokers, too. So call today. 800-957-6068. 800-957-6068. That's 800-957-6068.
Perry locked himself out of his car. Should he A, call his amateur wrestler friend with fists of steel, or B, get roadside assistance from the Geico mobile app? The correct answer is B. The Geico mobile app uses GPS, so Perry can get roadside assistance quickly without saying a word. It's like telepathy. Perry's steel-fisted friend would dent up the door and break stuff. Geico's mobile app is speedy and makes it easy for Perry to get roadside assistance with the tap of his finger.
Geico. Wherever, whenever. Just a click away with our free mobile app.
We've all experienced it. That moment when your mind is focused and you feel like you can accomplish anything. That moment now comes in a bottle. Introducing No-Dose Energy Shots. The shot that provides hours of energy to power your mind. Just what you'd expect from the No-Dose brand. A trusted leader in mental alertness for 50 years. New No-Dose Energy Shots. A sharper you awaits inside. Only at Walmart. Go to walmart.com for a $2 coupon.
Use this caffeine supplement as directed. For adults only. Limit use of other caffeine sources.
Have you heard? Proactive is America's top acne system because it's fast and gentle, and it's all about prevention. So stay tuned for a chance to participate in a 60-day trial to prove it. Do you have troubled skin, acne? With Proactive, you can heal your acne and help prevent new breakouts. Right now, in this radio area, we're looking for just 50 people with moderate acne to demonstrate exactly how fast Proactive works. The first 50 callers who qualify can try Proactive risk-free for 60 days. And you get our dermatologist's clear skin or it's free guarantee. Plus, the trial includes our legendary refining mask and green tea moisturizer free. Be one of the 50 lucky people to complete this 60-day risk-free trial. You won't see this offer in stores or on TV. It's a radio exclusive. Supplies are limited and the trial offer ends soon. So call now. 1-800-569-4918. That's 1-800-569-4918. 1-800-569-4918.
Hey, with us now, we are pleased to welcome L.A. City Councilmember Paul Koretz with news on the recently enacted ban on the use of bullhooks in the city. Paul is a longtime advocate for animals, and last year about this time, Paul joined us to discuss restrictions on the sale of purpose-bred pets in Los Angeles. Welcome to the program, Paul.
Good morning. Thanks for having me.
So the so-called bullhooks used in elephant training and performances, describe bullhooks and how they are used.
Well, they're a metal rod with a couple places that are very sharp and painful. And elephants have very sensitive skin, and they're used, in my view, to hit the elephant and inflict significant pain break them in training and then keep them in line and dominated during their performance lifetime.
Paul, what's the background on how and why Los Angeles became interested in these devices specifically?
Well, I was informed of some of these bad practices by an animal welfare advocate and friend, and I started looking into it. I walked with the animals 1 year with the elephants and other animals from the train station to Staples Center. I saw some video that was incredibly disturbing, which I played at the council meeting the day of the vote on the issue and also in committee, showing elephants just being routinely whacked one after another down the line, and a trainer saying, if you can't whack these elephants until they scream, you don't belong here. That was really enough for me. It's very clear that it's a very cruel practice, and that's really the only way they seem to be able to train and maintain elephants in the circus.
Who wrote the current legislation, and what does it state?
Well, I wrote the legislation, and we considered various steps, but the one we ultimately approved was a ban on the use of bull hooks with a three-year phase-in period. So in 3 years, circuses with elephants in all likelihood will not be able to perform in Los Angeles unless they find a non-cruel way to do it, which seems to be not possible.
Yeah, that's so great, Paul. Who supported the law and who opposed it?
Well, as it turned out on the council, much to my surprise, because when this started, we questioned whether we had a majority. It was unanimously voted for by the council. The main opposition was AEG and Staples Center because, at least for a time, they will lose business. Some of the labor unions that are directly affected, the Teamsters, which have some drivers from St. Louis to drive the elephants around, some IATSE and hotel and restaurant workers who work the concessions and set up the stages, they all would be somewhat impacted. And that's a large part of why we had the three-year phase-in. So any facility that had circuses involving elephants and bull hooks would have the time to replace those acts, or those circuses would have the time to eliminate elephants or their mistreatment from their performances.
And that's really our goal, isn't it, Paul, to just not use elephants when we have circuses, right? I mean, do you
think... Ultimately, that is the goal. And, personally, I think all exotic animals should be eliminated from circuses. But I think trying to do that now as a first step wasn't practical because I think there's much more education and awareness of how elephants are mistreated. I think trying to make the further argument would have been too much of a reach. But the goal is not just to keep them out of Los Angeles, which, while it's a nice first step, really is not going to accomplish much. It just means they go to Inglewood or Santa Ana or wherever the next closest place is. When we really have the impact is when 20 or 30 major cities have followed our example, and it starts to become impractical for a show like Ringling Brothers to continue traveling around using elephants and using bull hooks to maintain them.
Right, and it definitely is a good first step. It, like you said, it's going to be hard for elephants to participate in circuses without the use of the bull hooks here. I guess the only difference is instead of the three-year phase-in period, I would have urged you to do a three-month or one-year phase-in period. But
well, the thing, you know, there's been some controversy about that, and I think what I'm trying to get across to people is that I wouldn't have done it except that I think when it goes into effect is actually meaningless. because whether we do it the next year that Ringling Brothers would come to town or 3 years from now, it's not going to have any impact on the elephants themselves. They'll or the act or anything else. They'll just go on to the next city. They'll just skip L.A. They'll just reschedule their time. But what makes a difference is when is really the symbolic fact that we've done it and other places are looking at it and saying, well, L.A. did it. It's time for us to do it. And there's no impact locally. Honestly, we do nothing for the elephants. So it's only when everybody's doing it that it matters. And that's not going to happen in the next 3 years. So really, while people felt that we're harming the elephants and making them endure cruel practices for an extra 3 years, really all we're doing is we're allowing them to perform at Staples instead of the Inglewood Forum. It's only when the next place is down the road, you know, up and down the state and at least the West Coast have adopted it, that it really has the impact.
I mean, if I thought it
had any impact on the animals themselves, I wouldn't have done the extension. I actually thought the 3 years was a good idea because we're not trying to take away business from Staples Center. We're only trying to help the elephants. And really, I don't believe there's any difference in the impact on them for the three-year phase then.
Paul, I want you to respond to the statement. Stephen Payne, Vice President of Field Entertainment, parent company of Ringling Brothers, Circa, said, quote, "We've been taking care of exotic animals, including Asian elephants, for almost 144 years. We really, really are proud of the animal care we provide. Sadly, this ordinance before the city council, we feel, is just being driven by a small, vocal group of animal rights activists who are against animals and entertainment, whether they're elephants or any other animal."
Well, I don't know about small group. I would include myself among the people that he's talking about. So it's not just activists; it's also decision makers on the city council. Would we like to eliminate all exotic animals in the circus? I probably would, because I think just the process of constantly living on trains and in constant movement and the cruelty of their training.
And how they got the elephants and how they got the animals.
Oh, and when they first get the elephants in the wild, a lot of baby elephants are absolutely tortured, especially in Africa or Asia where they get them in the first place. There's nothing positive about it in terms of the experience for the animals. So I would say it doesn't mean that I wouldn't like to see tigers out of the circus, too. I think we just recognize that elephants are mistreated the most, and there's the most awareness of it. But I would say in 20 years, it's likely that circuses won't have any exotic animals.
Do the citizens of L.A. strongly support this legislation?
I believe they do. I mean, I've had a few people complain that their kids won't be able to see elephants in the circus, but I think by and large people understand the cruelty
Good.
You know, I'm not getting people complaining. I've had controversial issues where some of my constituents complain. We did a ban on plastic bags to save the resources that 2 billion plastic bags a year handed out at supermarkets would save. And we got some people complaining that they didn't want to lose their free plastic bags. But I'm not getting a lot of people complaining that, you know, we're going to lose elephants in the circus. I don't think there's...
L.A. Councilmember Paul Koretz, you are a great friend to animals. Thank you for coming on the show. After the break, people are dying of resistant bacterial infections. Why are antibiotics failing us? Yes, it's an animal story and a big one. Are you ready, Peter?
Looking for a shed toe. 21 rooms, but one will do. I don't want to buy it. I just want to rent it for an hour or two.
This is Dr. Lori Kirshner, and I want to thank you for joining us on Animals Today. Each week, we explore the wide variety of important issues concerning the welfare of animals, how people treat them, and where they fit in our society. From whale protectors on the open seas to lawyers in court to scouts helping their local shelter, join me to get the latest on animal welfare news, stories, and events from around the world. And visit us on Facebook to join the conversation. That's Animals Today every week right here on the station, 5 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. Also, make sure to visit us at animalstodayradio.com, where you can listen to any of our previous shows free. Animals Today brings you the highest quality, most up-to-date information about all animal welfare topics. Much of our support comes from the nonprofit group Advancing the Interests of Animals. Check them out at aianimals.org. That's aianimals.org. And thanks for listening.
That's the sound of a dog whose vocal cords were cut just to stifle her voice. It's called devocalization, and it's done to cats as well. Devocalized animals rasp and wheeze, cough and gag the rest of their lives. Some are rendered mute. And for what? So a commercial or hobby breeder can keep many animals without having to listen to them. So show dogs will be quiet in transit between shows or in the ring. So an irresponsible pet owner can leave a dog alone for hours every day. Animals Today joins with Coalition to Protect and Rescue Pets in saying shame on anyone who would have a dog or cat devocalized, and shame on the vets who perform this inhumane, unnecessary surgery for them. Please speak out against devocalization of dogs and cats. Use your voice. Protect theirs.
This message is sponsored by Advancing the Interests of Animals. You can check them out at aianimals.org.
Hey, new kid. Ever have that dream where nothing works? Orders are backed up, production lines not producing, management screaming, no solution in sight? Not me. Why? Grainger. Grainger's got everything we need. In a book, an app, a website, hundreds of branches. Knowing a solution is on its way soothes me to sleep at night. I love the Grainger catalog in all its forms. Get it? Got it? Good. Call, click Grainger.com, or stop by. Grainger, for the ones who get it done.
GEICO presents a man who just saved on his motorcycle insurance.
First off, my name is Daryl. Second, this is no motorcycle. This monster is 1,100 cc's of raw internal combustion power.
Feel the ground shake!
Now, I know what you're thinking. Where's this science teacher's logical attitude that goes with his sensible sneakers? Well, Mr. Rains on my parade, I saved a bunch on motorcycle insurance with GEICO. Now, if you'll excuse me, I've got some young minds that need molding.
GEICO Motorcycle. See how much you could save.
I just sneaked into my kids' rooms and took temperatures while they're sleeping, thanks to my Exergen thermometer. All I did was swipe their foreheads for a few seconds. It didn't even wake them up. My sister, the nurse, told us about the Exergen temporal scanner thermometer, and it's the best. Real value for the money and truly a lifesaver. Now I don't have to deal with ears or rears, if you know what I mean.
I'm Dr. Frank Pompei, founder of Exergen. Thousands of hospitals and clinics rely on temporal scanners. I'm confident you will too.
The Exergen temporal scanner. Pick one up at Costco and other fine retailers, or visit us at Exergen.com.
Want an easy-to-install floor and an easy-to-save price? Then get to Lumber Liquidators, because we've got all easy-click floors on sale in over 110 varieties. All laminate flooring is 20% off. Plus, get easy-click hardwood, easy-click bamboo, and more for up to 58% less than comparable floors at big box stores. Better yet, all Morningstar bamboo and Tranquility vinyl floors are on sale and get special financing. Better get clicking. Sales going on now. Visit LumberLiquidators.com or your local store today.
What is term life insurance? It's basically a financial protection plan for your family if you pass away. It can be a hard purchase. Think about it. It's one of the few major purchases you can make that you will personally never use. But you've got to have it to protect your family. And you owe it to yourself to shop and compare to get the best possible rates. For term life insurance policies of $500,000 or more, call the Term Lifeline today.
800-957-6068. That's 800-957-6068. Remember, we specialize in term life insurance policies of $500,000 or more. And we have great rates for smokers, too. So call today. 800-957-6068. 800-957-6068. That's 800-957-6068.
Thank you.
Welcome back to Animals Today. I'm Dr. Lori Kushner. Hi, Peter.
Hey, how are you doing?
There must be a Cher story coming up.
Well, it could be a Sonny Bono story.
It could be a Sonny Bono story.
But it's not.
Okay, what did Cher do?
Cher got her Twitter device activated.
Uh-oh. And, that means trouble.
She tweeted recently at Ringling Brothers saying the following: they should be put in jail for all the pain they've put their animals through.
Oh, good.
So that is Cher.
What was she doing at Ringling Brothers?
Well, she was commenting up about their behavior generally.
Yeah, that's great.
So thank you, Cher.
It's
you know, you got to pick and choose these quotes. So.
I know.
So it's just sort of cherry picking, but we agree with her on that one.
We do.
So thank you, Cher.
Yeah.
But now to something slightly more scientific here. Just hot news is that researchers have quantified the energy cost it takes for an animal to sort of get around after it is tagged with a radio transmitter or similar device for scientific research purposes.
Mm-hmm.
And previously, this has been felt to be sort of trivial. You got a little device on it. It doesn't look like it's doing much of anything. It provides data. Then you can see the natural behavior of turtles and mammals and fish and birds and all sorts of stuff like that, right? Well, now these researchers developed a device, and they are measuring on models how much drag these things create. And it turns out it's a lot.
You know,
increases the drag a lot. And that, over time, can sap the energy of the animals, change their behaviors, and alter even their data and harm these specific animals.
To me, it seems obvious that it would.
Mm-hmm.
To me, it would never seem just trivial. It seems obvious. And in addition, causing a lot of stress to the animal. You have to catch the animal, tag it, and you just don't know what happens. You don't know how much stress that's involved.
Well, I believe that the casual observation, maybe not to your eye, but it was felt that these little devices would not do much because they appeared pretty small and somewhat aerodynamic in their configuration.
So what are they going to do with these findings?
Well, the findings are really refreshed. So the whole community has to sort of take this all in and decide whether it believes it. I imagine it needs to be replicated. And you're going to have to modify these devices, make them smaller. I don't think the scientists are going to give this up. It's very allegedly provides valuable information. I'm not sure they're ready to give it up. But if nothing else, the devices need to get smaller and more streamlined.
Right.
So it's an interesting field of study. We'll see where.
Well,
see where it goes.
I agree. They're not going to give it up. It's going to be a while before they give it up.
Yeah. This one I just had to share with you because we have sort of something that we've known for a long time that what are called chicken nuggets, various fast food places and make them and sell them. We've not eaten them for decades, right? Even if they were what they purported to be, we wouldn't be eating them. But now a great new study has just been published where microscopic pathologic analysis of these nuggets has been performed. And so basically you treat the nugget as you would treat it with a sample of tissue for processing it, and you stain it, and you look at it under a microscope, which was done, and then you sort of see what you have there. And what do you think is there?
Well, I don't know.
Well, it's not just a pure striated muscle like you would expect from a chicken breast or chicken muscle.
Right.
You have fat, large quantities of it. You have epithelium, bone, nerve, connective tissue, plus a little bit of the muscle.
Yeah, that's really disgusting.
And that's great.
But see, maybe that doesn't bother chicken nugget eaters.
Yeah.
They don't care. It tastes good to them. What does it matter what it's made of, as long as it's made of an animal, and it doesn't matter which part. You think that's what they think?
I wonder. I think if you show this graphically to folks who have deluded themselves into believing that they are getting a piece of chicken breast and they're giving their four-year-old a wholesome, quote-unquote, piece of chicken this will make them think twice.
Okay, you might be right, but to me, a chicken breast, eating a chicken breast is just as disgusting as eating a chicken nerve or chicken whatever, bone.
I hear you.
Yeah.
I hear you, but you are not them.
Okay.
You're different, and maybe this will be a, maybe the...
So all fast food restaurants?
Well, they only studied two different national fast food chains. So
big name chains, do you want to tell us? You just
I am not disclosing.
You're just playing with us here. Okay.
I'm playing.
So what
I'm
do you
chicken to tell you that. I'm gonna try to find that the photograph of the photomicrograph and post it because I think it's just a powerful image, but we'll see.
Okay, we'll see.
And PBS Frontline has been investigating and doing a great sort of series of reports about the emergence of bacteria that are resistant to all known antibiotics and killing people. So it's becoming more and more common. Hospitals don't like to talk about it. Patients are dying. Patients are being treated by repetitive greater amputations when all the drugs available are not working. And so we are entering this era where there's fewer and fewer antibiotics to treat bad infections.
And why is this happening?
Well, first of all, for the past 50 years has been the greater and greater use of indiscriminate antibiotics for people and especially in the agricultural industry. Do you know that 80% of all antibiotics are being fed to animals that are being raised in factory farms?
Yeah, that's tragic.
Okay?
Yeah.
So these animals, this indiscriminate use of antibiotics, which are used to make the animals get bigger faster and increase the efficiency of the operations, these antibiotics end up in the society generally, in our environment, in food, in our water, in the waste of the animals, in our vegetables. And so that leads to pressure for resistant bacteria that are no longer susceptible to the antibiotics when we really need them.
And you said 80%?
80%.
What a shame.
So where do we go from here? Well, the other problem is that the drug companies don't no longer want to develop antibiotics. It's not good business for them. So it's going to be a whole new world.
Wow. Great job, Peter. Great news. Thank you for listening to Animals Today. This is Dr. Lori Kirshner encouraging you to nurture your love and compassion for the only other beings sharing our planet, the animals.
The opinions you hear on the Business Talk Radio Network are those of the host, callers, and guests, and not necessarily those of this station, Business Talk Radio Network, its management, or advertisers. The information on the Business Talk Radio Network does not constitute a recommendation, offer, or solicitation to buy or sell any product or securities. Investing involves risks, so please consult a professional before investing. If you have any questions or comments about the Business Talk Radio Network, contact us at 203-323-7300 or at our website, businesstalkradio.net.
USA News, I'm Sean Scott Ferguson. President Barack Obama and fellow Democrats attempted on Sunday to tap into voter anger about a 16-day U.S. government shutdown and turn Virginia's upcoming governor's election into a referendum on Tea Party conservatives. With Democratic candidate Terry McAuliffe leading polls over Republican Ken Cuccinelli before Tuesday's vote, Obama and Democratic speakers at a rally in the Washington suburb of Arlington pressed party activists to focus on turning out the vote. The deaths of two French journalists in northern Mali have been described by France's foreign minister as cold and calculated assassinations. Laurent Fabius said the journalists were killed on a desert track 7 miles east of Kidal. Australia's New South Wales State's Rural Fire Service issued an emergency warning for two wildfires fanned by strong winds and soaring temperatures on Sunday. Firefighting crews backed by helicopters and aircraft are battling to protect homes and properties in the Lower Portland area of west of Sydney. This is IRN USA News.
Ladies, are any of these symptoms familiar? Hot flashes, sleeplessness, irritability? How about low libido or weight gain? If you're a woman over 40 experiencing any of these symptoms, you probably have hormonal imbalance. And until you balance your hormones, it can be practically impossible to get relief from these problems. But you're in luck, because Ambrin can help you balance hormones and relieve your hot flashes, sleeplessness, irritability, and other symptoms of menopause. And now you can finally lose weight. Yes, even that stubborn body fat with Ambrin Weight Loss, a powerful new product that will help you get the results you want. So you can finally lose the weight and all those other awful menopause symptoms. Call now and ask how you can get your free sample of Ambrin Weight Loss. Just call 1-800-261-7405. This is a limited-time offer, so don't wait. Call Ambrin right now. 1-800-261-7405. That's 1-800-261-7405. 1-800-261-7405.
An Italian magazine said that a United States spy agency had eavesdropped on Vatican phone calls, possibly including when former Pope Benedict's successor was under discussion, but the Holy See said it had no knowledge of any such activity. Panorama magazine said that among 46 million phone calls followed by the U.S. National Security Agency in Italy from December 10, 2012 to January 8, 2013, were conversations in and out of the Vatican. New York doctors and Obamacare equals a problem. Precious Watson explains.
A new survey reveals that New York doctors are treating Obamacare like the plague. A poll conducted by the New York State Medical Society finds that 44% of MDs said they are not participating in the nation's new health care plan. Another 33% of MDs said they're still not sure whether to become Obamacare providers. 23% of the 409 physicians surveyed said they're taking patients who signed up through health exchanges.
For the latest news and analysis, log on to IRNUSANews.com.
Have you heard about the no-no hair removal device that's sweeping the globe? If you want to go weeks without shaving and get smooth, professional, quality results, here's our favorite host, Cheryl.
Hey, gals, I love talking about my no-no. It's this cute little hair removal system that you can take with you and use almost anywhere at home or on the road. Try no-no hair risk-free by calling 1-800-351-5917. That's 800-351-5917. Or go to nonoradio.com.
The first freely elected Egyptian president, Mohamed Morsi, goes on trial on Monday, the second time in just over 2 years that a deposed president has found himself in court in Egypt, a pivotal Arab nation some fear is sliding back into autocratic rule. The trial raises the fear of deepening instability in the Arab world's most populous country. India's intergalactic ambitions will take a further step forward this month when its unmanned Mars orbiter blasts off on a nine-month voyage to the Red Planet. The BBC's Yogita LeMay reports.
India's ambitions in space are about to take off. 5 years ago, it launched Chandrayaan-1, an unmanned mission to the moon, and now it's looking far beyond. This is the spacecraft that will take